الحمد لله رب العالمين الحمد لله رب العالمين وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له اللهم صل وسلم على سيدنا وحبيبنا مولانا محمد الذي أرسلته رحمة للعالمين أما بعد أوصيكم ونفسي بتقوى الله From time to time As an imam, and as many other imams will encounter situations and encounters and dealing with people's problems and hearing things that most people perhaps will not hear in depth. And a lot of the time, people who are dealing with people and trying to be beneficial to people will tend to hear things. We tend to hear people's problems in their lives, with their children, with their wives, with themselves, and so forth. And a person can think about very deeply there are many causes of a lot of the people's problems. And we can find out of one of the many causes, عدم الخوف, lack of fear of Allah Azza wa Jal, a lack of fear of the hellfire. And the lack of fear comes from a lack of reminder. So today, inshallah, we're going to remind ourselves, and we're going to remind yourselves, inshallah, and we're going to remind people who are listening to the recording, and we're going to remind the people who are listening outside, be they people who are Muslim, or be they people who aren't Muslim, inshallah, everybody needs to have some fear of Allah Azza wa Jal. And in this we find that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions in the Quran many ayat. And from amongst the verses of the Quran, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions, Ya ayyuha an-nas ittaqu rabbakum. All mankind, fear Allah. Allah said this, fear me. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions many aspects, many reasons to fear Him, many reasons to obey Allah Azza wa Jal. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions in the Quran, إِنَّ زَلْزَلَةَ السَّاعَةِ شَيْءٌ عَظِيمٌ. Verily, the shaking of the sa'ah, the hour, will be a huge thing. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gives us examples of people's fear on Yawm al-Qiyamah. يَوْمَ تَرَوْنَهَا تَدْهَلُ كُلُّ مُرْضَعَةٍ عَمَّا أَرْضَعَتْ. On that day, you're going to see women who will be having children who they breastfed, they will leave their child, they will leave their baby, and they will flee from this baby and not breastfeed this child. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will say, وَتَضَعُ كُلُّ ذَاتِ حَمْلٍ حَمْلَهَا. And on that day, you're going to see that women who are heavily pregnant on the day of judgment, they were going to drop their load, or they're going to have miscarriages. And one of the ways that people can have miscarriages is due to severe shock or trauma. And there'll be no more severe shock or trauma than on the day of judgment. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions, whatever nas sukara. You will see people, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, we're going to see people intoxicated in a drunken state. In ghafla, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will say, وَمَا هُمْ بِسُكَارَ. There are not people who are drunk, there are not people who are intoxicated. However, وَلَكِنْ عَذَابَ اللَّهِ شَدِيدٌ. The punishment of Allah Azza wa Jal is severe. And we can go on and on many verses of the Quran that talk about the fear, and Allah putting fear. But we're going to move on, inshaAllah, and talk about the ahadith. In the hadith that's muttafaq alayh, narrated by Imam Bukhari and Imam Muslim, in which the ulama say that this hadith has put more fear into the ulama, into the awliya, into the saliheen's heart than any other hadith. And it begins like this, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says that the creation, every one of us, will go through stages in their creation, and they will start as semen, a drop of liquid, that will be in the womb. Then 40 days later, there will be a alaqah, a clot of blood. And then 40 days later, there will be a mudghah, which is a lump of flesh. And then after this, another 40 days, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sends an angel down. An angel then writes down the rizq, the provisions of this child. So every one of us sitting here, an angel has come to their mother's womb. When you were in your mother's womb, an angel came and asked Allah, what's the rizq of this person? How much will be his wage? Who will be his wife? Where is he going to live? How much food is he going to eat? Down to the last breath. Down to the last tanafus, the last breath you're going to take. Down to the heartbeat, exactly. Every single breath, every single heartbeat will be counted. And then the angel then will write down whatever Allah says. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala then orders the angel to write his ajal, his lifespan. How long are you going to live for? 40 years, 6 months, 4 weeks, 3 days, and 2 hours and 5 seconds. Down to the last second. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will mention to the angel the deeds, the a'mal, the type of things you're going to do in this world. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will tell, finally, the angel, whether you are going to be shaqi or sa'id, whether you are going to be somebody who's destined for the hellfire or destined for hell. And we need to understand here that you have hurriya, you have the free will to choose your path, which way you're going to go. However, the hadith then goes on and takes a dramatic turn. And the hadith goes on to mention that a person will do the works, will do the a'mal of Ahlul Jannah, حَتَّى مَا يَكُونَ بَيْنَهُ وَبَيْنَهَا إِلَّا ذِرَاعٌ, until they only, between him and heaven is an arm span, or a length of a forearm, ذِرَاعٌ, which is less than a meter. So he can see heaven, he probably can smell it. He's doing so much good works, prayer, zakah, hajj, coming to the masjid, doing all these good things, being nice to his neighbors. And then he does the acts, a'mal, ahlil nar, he does the actions of the people of the hellfire, and then he goes to hell. And then we have the opposite. And the ulama say that the opposite is more common. That a person will do the a'mal, will do the works of the people of hellfire, until between him and hell is one dira', a forearm. He can see hell, he probably can feel the heat, he's on the edge of falling into the hellfire. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala then inspires this person to start doing good deeds, to start to change his life, to start to make tawbah, to start to want to think deeply about where he is going, to start now to get up and pray, to start now to make his relationship between him and Allah correct before he passes away. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala then, because of this, enters the person into heaven. Walakin, how many of us here, we don't know. Before we die, we may take a wrong turn out of our own free will and start doing the actions of the people of Ahlul Nar and enter into the hellfire. And this is why the ulama have said that you should never, ever, ever look down on a person who's not practicing. A man came to me, he said to me many years ago that he was walking by the masjid and he was in a state where he wasn't practicing his faith. And a man who we have husn of them, a good opinion, the man had goodness in his heart. But the man went up to this man and said, have shame on you. You are in a state of ghafla, of heedlessness. You know, and he was in a state that wasn't becoming of a Muslim. And you should come to mosque. And this man became very upset and subhanAllah, you know, he held this in his heart. Well, like, and the point here is that we should not look down on brothers and sisters who perhaps don't come to the mosque. Yes, we should feel anxious that we want them to come to the masjid, like in there's ways of talking to people, there's ways of encouraging them to come back, but certainly we don't look down on anybody just because you're coming to the masjid praying 5 times a day, just because I'm making the khutbah, does not mean I'm going to die on la ilaha illallah, because we don't know. We're living in a time we're holding on to Islam is holding on to the jamrah, holding on to your Islam is holding on to a qawl, and people are leaving this deen and people are having fitna in their deen. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions many examples of fear. For one example, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi wa sallam has mentioned in the hadith that the feet لا تزول قدم عبد حتى يسأل عن عمره. A person that you and I, every person sitting here, you and I inshallah, that our feet on the day of judgment are not going to move until we're going to be cross-examined. And if you've ever been stopped at the airport, or interrogated, or stopped by the police, or in the court, or anything else, then you know it's not comfortable. You know it's very, very uncomfortable to be cross-examined and analyzed and scrutinized. Walakin, we are all going to face this obligatory hisab by Allah, not by some policeman, or not by a customs or inland revenue, or the police stopping you on the outside, or anybody else, or your wife, or your husband, or the sheikh, or the imam, or anybody else. You're going to be asked by Allah Azza wa Jal, and Allah is going to ask you several questions. He wants to know your life, fima afnah. How have you spent your life? How have you spent your life? What have you been doing with your life? Has it been in a state of ta'a, obedience, or ma'asiyah, disobedience? And then Allah Azza wa Jalla is going to ask, your wealth, مَالِهِ فِيمَا اكْتَسَبَهُ وَفِيمَا أَنْفَقَهُ. Your wealth, how have you gained your wealth? From haram means, from stealing, from cheating, from double-crossing, from lying, from interest, from usury. How have you gained your wealth? Have you cheated your way? Have you lied? And then, in what have you your nafaqah? In what way have you distributed your wealth? What have you spent your wealth? Have you spent it on your wife? Looking after her, giving her what she needs, looking after the needs of your children. Have you given out to people who are deserving? Or have you spent it on haram? Gambling. And sometimes, subhanAllah, and sometimes I go past the betting places and we see what appears to be some of our Muslim brothers. Walakin, we ask Allah Azza wa Jalla, guide some of our brothers, inshaAllah. And we don't look down on some of our brothers if they're misguided, fell off the path. Inshallah, we make dua. We ask Allah to guide him, because Allah can swap him, put you in there, and put him in here. So be under no illusions. Don't think that shaitan wasn't in Jannah. Yawm al-Ayyam. He was in heaven one day. And Allah told him, bow down to Adam alayhi salam. And he didn't bow down. And why should I bow down to him? I am made out of fire and nar. And he's from tin. He's from clay. I'm better than him. Allah Azza wa Jalla then kicked Iblis out. Kicked shaitan out of heaven. He was in Jannah, mashallah. And none of us are in Jannah at the moment. So we should be very careful not to be looking down on too many people or any of our brothers and sisters. And then, the next thing you're going to be asked about, you and I, جسمه فيما أبلاه. Your body or your health. And how have you looked after your body? Have you been taking drugs? Have you been taking alcohol? Have you been eating the wrong type of foods? Have you been abusing your body? Or abusing the bodies of other people? These are the things that you and I will have to be asked about. And inshallah, should ask yourself now, your body, your health. Are you looking after your health? Are you looking after your wealth? Where you're getting it from? And are you thinking about your actions? If Allah was to ask you now these questions, what are you going to say? What's your answer? And then we have a beautiful hadith that's very frightening, in which the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi wa sallam says to the Sahaba, if you knew what I know, لَذَحِكْتُمْ قَلِيلًا. If you knew what I know, the Prophet says, you would laugh less. وَلَبَكَيْتُمْ كَثِيرًا. And you would cry often if you knew what I knew. And then we find, in terms of fear, a hadith Sayyidina Aisha mentions to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi wa sallam, after the Prophet tells her on the day of judgment, people will be resurrected, barefooted, urah, naked. And then Sayyidina Aisha, she says, subhanAllah, the men are going to be looking at the women, and the women are going to be looking at the men, because they're naked. And then the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi wa sallam then changes her perception, changes her understanding, and changes our understanding, and says, al-amru ashaddu min dhalik. that the affair, that the affair of the next day, on the day of judgment, is so severe that you're not going to be looking at a naked woman. Now you imagine, subhanAllah, a woman who is naked in front of you, or a man who is naked in front of a woman, most people internally they'll be attracted to this. But imagine the fear you're going to have. You have no time to look at a naked woman or a naked man. You have no time. You are so scared. Al-amru ashaddu min dhalik. The affair is greater than this. And examples of the Sahaba, of the fear, the khawf. And the point is to get back to the fear of the Prophet and the fear of the Sahaba. And people say, oh, Sahaba, they're the companions. Walakin, who's our qudwa? Nabina Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi wa sallam. So Allah has given you a prophet, and Allah has made him a man, not an angel, so it's easy to copy. And has given him Sahaba, companions, for us to copy. So people shouldn't think and give excuses to themselves. They're the Sahaba. We can't be like them. We can't be like the great Sahaba. Na'am, in terms of darajat, they have the suhba. Na'am. Balakin, you have the ability to do what they did and leave what they left behind. And we find that one day a man had so much fear of the hellfire, and he was fatah. He was a young man. And the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi wa sallam, upon hearing that this man had so much khawf, that he locked himself away. He locked himself at home, and the Prophet went to go to visit him. And this is the rahmah of our Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi wa sallam. And the hadith narrated by Imam Hakim that the man, when the Prophet came to visit him, the man got up and hugged the Prophet, فَعَتَنَقَهُ. And then the Prophet sees that the man falls down dead. He dies. And the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam explains, and this is from his nabuwa. He says that this man is a jahizu sahibukum. Prepare your friend for burial. Why? Because the fear of Allah has killed this man. This man has died after the fear of Allah. And the last thing he did was hug the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And we find examples amongst the Sahaba that when verses of the Quran will be read, Sahaba would die. As narrated by Imam Hakim, a verse of the Quran was read and a young man died after the fear of Allah. And nowadays, most people's nasib, most people's portion of the Quran is that it sounds nice. But lakin, this is yani sathi, this is superficial. Get behind the ma'ani of the ayat of the Quran and then start to fear Allah when the verses are being read. And when you can reach the state and you start shaking, I'm going to mention the hadith in which the Prophet mentioned the shaking of a person, an example of the tree. And we find the hadith that Shaddad bin Aws, a great Sahabi, he said, I had sleepless nights. I can't sleep. And they asked, why? Why? Why can't you sleep? What's troubling you? Is it your money? Is it your wife? Is it you have family problems? What's going on? Are you sick? What's going on? What's so scary? Why are you not sleeping? And he says, Allahumma inna an-nar adhabat min an-nawm. That the fear of the hellfire has pushed away my sleep. I can't sleep. How can you sleep if you have this great torment, this punishment waiting for you in the next life? Adhabat anni an-nar. Allahumma inna an-nar adhabat anni, adhabat minni khawf. And have a money and no. Like, how has one night, any of us, me or you, one night, have you ever had a sleepless night because of the fear of Allah, because of the ma'asiyah? This is when we start doing this, when we start coming back to these type of things, when we start having ihya of these ma'ani fi qulubukum, then you see the Masr, you see the Fath, you see Palestine, and you see Syria, and you see Iraq, these type of things start to go away. When we have khawf. Because don't think Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is bringing this bala down because we are doing that which we should be doing. Bil-aks, we're doing that which we shouldn't be doing. And because of this, it's adab. Like, how many people are going to realize, إِنَّ اللَّهَ لَا يُغَيِّرُ مَا بِقَوْمٍ حَتَّى يُغَيِّرُ مَا بِأَنفُسِهِمْ. Allah is going to change the state of our people until they themselves change what's within them. And we have the key. The key to Syria, and the key to Iraq, and the key to Home Office or the foreign policy being changed. The key is within yourselves. Allah said, لا حتى يغيروا, until they change what's within themselves. So when you're still doing haram, when you're not praying Fajr on time, when you're having girlfriends, when you're having boyfriends, when you're doing things you shouldn't be doing, and then you wonder why our brothers, why we have jam'iyat, why we have mu'assasat to make money or to donate money for people, because of our dhunub, because of your ma'asi. Once we realize this, things will start to get better, and things will start to get easier for us, and it's historic. In tariq, in history, this is something that's mashhood. You can see for yourself, and we find that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi wa sallam, he mentions that there's a man, and this man, he makes a will, a wasiyah, and he says to his children, he gathers the children, he says to his children, look, I want you when I die to cremate me, to burn me, and this is haram, we can't cremate one another, it's haram, to cremate me, and then get my ashes, and put half of my ashes in the ocean, and half of my ashes in the land, spread them out in the wind. But, and he says, why? Because Allah, I fear Allah, if Allah is to resurrect me, and he thinks Allah won't do this, if Allah is going to resurrect me, he's going to punish me, unlike any other person, because of what I've done in my life. Look at this man, spent half, most of his life in ma'asiyah, like at the end he has so much fear of Allah, and his children carry out his will. And we have to be careful that our wills are done Islamically. Very important, inshaAllah, that a lot of people do their wills un-Islamically. And we have muarif, we have things, we have fractions to certain people. And this is a topic from another khutbah, inshaAllah ta'ala. Walakin the man then, whose ashes are scattered in the ocean, scattered in the earth, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Al-Qadir, gathers, he tells the ocean to gather his ashes, and tells the earth to gather his ashes, and he's resurrected. And Allah Azza wa Jal says to him, مَا حَمَلَكَ عَلَى ذَلِكَ? What made you do this? And then the man says, خَشْيَتُك, your fear. I fear you, I'm so scared of you, Ya Allah. That's why I did it. I'm trying to run away. I want my ashes to be scattered so I don't be resurrected. And Allah Azza wa Jal, أَرْحَمَ الرَّحِيمِ, he forgives him. So this is the fear that we need to have. This is the fear that we need to have. And the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi wa sallam, one day he was sitting near a tree with the Sahaba, and the wind came and blew the leaves off the tree, and the dry leaves fell down. And the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi wa sallam said to the Sahaba, do you know this tree? It resembles who? And the Sahaba said, Allahu Rasulullah A'lam. Allah, his messenger, know best. And the Prophet said, this is the mu'min. When he has fear, akshaarna, he shakes out of the fear of Allah Azza wa Jal, his bad deeds, they fall off. Like the tree, when the leaves, the dead leaves fall away, when you have fear of Allah Azza wa Jal, then things, your deeds, your bad deeds start to go away, and you're left with green, beautiful leaves. And this is your deeds, inshaAllah ta'ala. So prepare, fear Allah. Tell yourself to fear Allah when you can't get to the Fajr. Tell yourself to fear Allah when if you're having a relationship. Anybody is doing zina right now, and you may be thinking, مستحيل, كيف واحد يفعل زنا? I know. If people are doing zina, having a relationship that's haram, from now, ask Allah, Ya Allah, forgive me. Ask Allah from the bottom of your heart to stop. Give you the ability to stop, and stop having this haram relationship. And if you are not doing the thing you should be doing, ask Allah to forgive you and have fear of Allah and walk out that door, inshaAllah, and you're making a niyyah, I'm going to pray Fajr in the morning. You're making a niyyah to call this girl and say, I'm sorry, I can't continue with you. Or tell the boy, to the sisters, I can't continue with you. Make a niyyah, don't walk out this door and listen to what I'm saying, in from one ear and out from another ear. Because this is a hujjah against you and against me on Yawm al-Qiyamah. So we need to be people of action, we need to be people who hear the khutbah and go away and transform themselves. We're not here to be entertained, but we're here to be changed, inshaAllah, because our brothers and sisters all over the world, their blood is spilling too much, and it's all because of our ma'asi. Don't look anywhere else. It's not because of this or that, or this policy, or this policy, or that policy. It's all because of our dhunub. And anybody who has a basira in his heart, will understand what I'm trying to say, inshallah ta'ala, ya'lamu annahu la anfa' al-insani fi hadha zaman. بقناة الحسام أصدقته في سلاح الجهاد واستغفاري أنها أداري.